Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this day, the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. The summer is fleeing, I find, and as I go out and tend my garden and keep putting water on it. I just noticed that things are growing not this fast, but then I got a late start. But the summer is moving fast. So it's nice to be back after having been down at Melrose Lutheran last week. And it was a good time had by all. And now we're here. Just in case you might be wondering, Lisa is our usual special music accompaniment. Is visiting her sisters in Duluth this weekend, so we wish her well and a safe journey back home tomorrow. So we begin our service, and looking at the announcements, not a whole lot going on right now. If you have something though for the August newsletter, and that's why I say it's moving fast, please get that to Renee by tomorrow if you can. Also know that we do have midweek devotional videos on Wednesdays. And then, of course, the regular service next week. Please remember all these folks in your prayers that are listed. And also, do note a former pastor, Reverend Barbara Keening, is in Mandan in a facility still, and so she has some needs that we can help if you are so inclined. There's information in the bulletin here for that. The noisy bucket offering this week goes to the backpack program, which is very helpful in addressing hunger needs for children and families. So let's begin our service then, service of morning prayer, with the brief order for confession on page 56. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, the Apostle John writes, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our opening hymn, number 296, Just As I Am, Without One Plea.
O God, powerful and compassionate, You shepherd your people, faithfully feeding and protecting us. Heal each of us and make us a whole people, that we may embody the justice and peace of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
Our first reading is Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 1 through 6. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer to be dismayed, nor shall any of them be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. Here ends the first lesson. Our second lesson is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 to 22. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth called the uncircumcision by those who were called the circumcision, as physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into the holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Here ends the lesson.
Come away, to a deserted place all by yourselves and rest a while. For many were going and coming, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a deserted place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they hurried there on foot from all the towns and arrived ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. When they had crossed over, they came to land at Gennesaret and moored the boat. When they got out of the boat, people at once recognized him and rushed about that whole region and began to bring the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages or cities or farms, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might touch even the fringe of his cloak. And all who touched it were healed. This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus had sent his disciples out two by two with instructions, very specific instructions, telling them where to go and what to proclaim, what to do as far as healing and casting out demons, and not to take money, but to accept the hospitality of the people that amongst whom they went. And they went out, and they did many marvelous things in the Spirit and working in Jesus' name. And so they came back, and they reported, and that's where our gospel begins today. They are all excited about the many things that they have done. As I said, they healed many diseases and they cast out demons, all in Jesus' name. They were filled with the Spirit and energized. Jesus looked at them, and I think he saw where this could lead if they did not do something to take care of themselves. And so he encourages them, come away by yourselves. We'll go and pray. We'll reflect. We'll energize. We'll get rest and nourishment. And we'll be ready for more. So they were going across the lake, the Sea of Galilee, and they were going to find a place all by themselves just to go into retreat. And yet what happens? People see where they're going. People knew what they can do. People knew who Jesus was. And they ran around the lake and got there ahead of them. They collected all the sick that they could, and they brought them to Jesus for healing, and his disciples for healing. So there was not to be any self-care. There was not to be any rest, any respite at that time. But Jesus' instructions to them initially, of course, was that they needed to take care of themselves if they were going to care for others. If they were going to be his disciples, they needed to pace themselves, I suppose, to take a moment to reflect on what had happened in their ministry, to see where their power had come from, and not to be so excited that it might be coming from their own efforts, but rather from the Spirit of God. And Jesus was having compassion for them as he made these instructions. And now, of course, as they get out of the boat, hoping to find a place for retreat, Jesus sees the big crowd, the great throng, and he has again compassion for these people because they have such great need. Much as his disciples would have need unless they exercised some care, trusted in the Spirit and took time out. So these people, just from daily life, from the diseases and the demons of this world, had needs too great that they could not care for themselves, but they turned to the shepherd who had came in their midst. That's the way Jesus is. Week after week we hear about that here and in this place, in the Word. If you turn to the Word daily, you know this. You know the Good Shepherd. There's a Sunday, about three or four Sundays after Easter, called Good Shepherd Sunday. And again, the psalm is this 23rd psalm. And the lesson from the Gospel is from Jesus, I am the Good Shepherd. Today's lessons talk about shepherds too. Not necessarily the Good Shepherd. I don't know if you'd call this Bad Shepherd Sunday, but it's probably Shepherdless Sunday, maybe, because God is, in the first lesson, lamenting that the people of Israel did not have the shepherds they needed to provide for their spiritual nourishment. He had set up all this, all these laws and this religion, this faith for them to live by. And yet their leaders were forsaking that and turning to other things and just exercising leadership for their own glory and honor. So there's lamentation in the Old Testament lesson for the lack of a shepherd. And as Jesus notes, when he gets out and he looks at the crowd, they too were like sheep without the shepherd. And so there he was. And he began to teach them many things. And wherever he went, people would be bringing folks to him for healing. It makes me think now about your life. Because maybe we assume you come here to church, you're faithful people, you know what's what, and you know where to turn. But maybe you don't have everything all together. Maybe there's some parts in your life, maybe just generally in need of more. So I ask you this day to think and ponder. You who are faithful, you who know to come and to listen to the Word, what are your ongoing needs? Where do you still need the shepherd? Because you'll never not need Jesus. What are your spiritual needs? I mean, if you're hungry, you know you can go to the food pantry. If you're weary, you know you should go lie down, take a nap. Or at least also find ways to regenerate and rejuvenate. But maybe there's a spiritual weariness that you have ongoing. Maybe you just need words of encouragement now and then, and I try to provide those, but maybe I could always use more instruction to do it better. Maybe we all need to think about together what we can say and do that would provide further encouragement and hope and help in your life as you go about your business day to day. Where do you need the Good Shepherd to come into your life? Of course, first and foremost, I would remind you again to pray, to consider all that Jesus can do. And yes, it is not just a magic hocus-pocus formula that you just say a few words and you're all better. Sometimes it's an ongoing process of self-examination and reflection, of listening and paying attention to what kind of things you can do. What is God telling you to do, and what is He leading you to go in your spiritual journey? What is He leading you to think about the parts of your life that you need addressed that maybe you gloss over? I do that. I'm sure you do that too. There are times that we would rather not address some things. There are glaring needs to be met. Because Jesus is more than willing. He has come to earth to address these things. And He looks upon you. You might not think about that. Are you aware of the eyes of Jesus? Always watching. Always keeping an eye. Not just on what you do, on what you're doing moment by moment, so He can clobber you when you're doing something bad, but watching you to see where you could use a hand, where you might need a word of instruction, a word of hope, words to help. Just as the disciples needed reminders to take time and care, you too need that word. You too need time to reflect and relax and rest. And when I say relax, I mean relax if you are in the habit of beating yourself up over things, mistakes, and things you might do. You need that word of forgiveness as well from Jesus' mouth. And so I say to you, the Good Shepherd is here. Not me. Hopefully I'm one of those that aren't just a hireling, but one that maybe can assist the Good Shepherd in helping you find your way. And we are shepherds one to another. Keep that in mind as well. I'm not the only one. You turn to a friend who might have words of encouragement. Speak to them too. Family, friends, and neighbors. Because we are all shepherds. In Jesus' name, amen. Now we'll sing a hymn, 456, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.
Thank you.
Will you please stand? Turn to page 65 for the confession of our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Turn and greet your neighbor with the peace of God. I notice some are already starting to shake hands again. But that's their family, so. Okay. Maybe one day, too, we'll be doing that more. The offering plate and an icy bucket are on the back table. Thank you for supporting this congregation and for putting your offering in. If you haven't, you can do so on the way out. But we'll sing the offertory, Create in Me. Session are on the back of the celebrate folder. We pray together. Rooted in Christ, sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Tend your church, O God. Encourage bishops, pastors, and deacons in their proclamation of the gospel. Raise up new leaders and encourage those pursuing a call to ministry. Embolden all the baptized to embody your love and justice. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Restore your creation, O God. Sustain croplands and pastures and safeguard all farm animals and livestock. Preserve lakes, rivers, and streams that offer refreshment. Revive lands recovering from natural disasters and protect coastlands threatened by rising oceans. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Reconcile the nations, O God. Break down the dividing walls that make us strangers to one another and unite us as one human family. Equip leaders to deal wisely with conflict and guide diplomats who seek peaceful solutions. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Help your people, O God. Look with compassion on immigrants, exiles, and all who are afraid or feel lost. Give rest to those who are weary, comfort to those who are grieving, and recovery to those who are ill. Especially Pastor Barb, and others whom we name in our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Nourish this congregation, O God. Prepare a table where we receive food for our hungering spirits. Renew our commitment to provide for one another and revitalize our ministries of feeding and nurturing hungry neighbors. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
For those folks out west in our country and in Canada who are suffering from the wildfires, and that extends all across our country with the smoky haze that covers our land. And for those in Germany and Northwest Europe who are suffering great floods, we ask your help in these places for all natural disasters. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You lead us home, O God. We give thanks for all who have died, now citizens with the saints, especially those we remember in our hearts. As you have received them into your heavenly home, so welcome all of us to dwell in your house forever. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now, while we turn to our final hymn, number 369, we'll sing three verses, 1, 3, and 5.
Peace.
Serve the Lord.
We will. Thank you.